Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
He's absolutely Jason, he's absolutely gay. He'll absolutely brighten up the darkest rainy day. He's funny and loves movies, he's smart and he's a Jew. He's an actor and an activist and wants to hear from you.
Get out!
Yeah, and then last year I was in a film. When do we start?
Oh! Hi! Welcome to the show. Why did you start before I said we could start? Oh, Jake is being a little aggressive today. So he's been a little aggressive because it's Turkey Day tomorrow and he's hungry.
And he wants to get out and have some
stuffing. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Absolutely Jason Stewart. Got me. Ugh. Anyway, the show never starts like this. So fans at home, we are never this unprofessional. But I'm really excited because I met you a couple months ago at a film festival. You had a wonderful film called Come See Me. And this lady's name is Jessica. Say the last name so I don't butcher it.
Well, it's Jenica.
Jenica. He threw me off completely.
And you are?
Jason Stewart.
Got it.
Boring.
Jenica Berger.
Jenica Berger. And Jenica and I felt like I connected with you the minute
yes.
I saw the film, and I connected with your work. And I was so excited about the idea that you created your own thing and you had such talented people and it was such a diverse cast. And not only was it diverse in terms of age and color and the kind of person, and we were just talking about that before Jake decided that the show was starting before he told me. No. No, we're perfect. You're perfect.
Don't ever change.
Don't
always
ever change.
Wear the headband.
He always does. It's his trademark.
So cute.
But no one can see him because he's behind the glass. So he's like Oz.
Right. I am the great Oz.
Powerful Oz. He is powerful because he gets to do whatever he wants. He's in charge. But I went to see it and I was very impressed by your positive attitude, your creativity, and the idea that you got this done. And it was what I really loved about the films also was the acting style of the film, the realness of it, the intimacy of the characters, and how funny it was.
Oh, thank you.
And it came from the kind of funny that I like is it came from the situation of what was going on, and there was funny people, but it came from a real place rather than joke.
Right.
Which I think is sort of old school and no longer really something that I'm interested in a viewer in watching.
Right.
Yeah.
You mean you don't like mainstream comedies?
That kind of sitcom doesn't make me laugh anymore because I can see the joke coming a mile away.
I can't watch any TV, to be honest with you.
Really?
Think,
come on.
There's so much great TV. I cannot watch it because I'm thinking she got that job.
Really?
Yeah. I'm too competitive. And I also know that the only time I've been taken out and really into the world was The Sopranos. Because I would have nothing to do with the mafia. I knew none of those
actors.
So as
long as you're not, so as people are getting killed and running down the street, so how about The Walking Dead?
No, because I know people on the
Obsessed.
Show. So I'm like,
Glenn is alive! Glenn is alive!
I don't even know what that means.
A lot of people do. So tell me, how did this film come about? Why did you do it? And everything. I want to know the whole trajectory of the film and how it started, because I thought it was just wonderful.
Thank you. Yeah, you were a huge support, and so was Patricia Richardson, who was
she's a friend.
And she had said that you guys wanted to leave because you were there for the short films.
Yes.
And begrudgingly sitting there, and then you so enjoyed it. It was a delightful surprise. So it really moved me, what you guys said, because I was glad that I made your butt warm in the seat, like you enjoyed your seat. I had created a TV show for myself. It's called The Jenica Project. I performed a one-woman show called You Can Eat Me, and it was about my husband being a chef to celebrities, and I want to be one. And I told everybody in my life, my managers, my agents, everybody, I'm going to write myself the perfect material, I'm going to put it up, and I'm going to sell it. I performed it 4 times, and we sold it to Nickelodeon for Nick at Night. And in that process of development, they said, you can't star in it. the name can't be Jenica, the name can't be Josh, the daughter's name can't be True, and so on and so forth. And by the time we had finished developing...
Wait, what? Josh?
Yeah, my husband. They wouldn't even go with Josh.
What's wrong with Josh?
I'm apparently... It's not a good
racist.
Name.
Racist.
Absolutely racist against. Isn't that a Jewish name?
I don't know what. It's Bible.
Biblical.
Yeah, I mean, the Bible. What could be better than the Bible?
Like biblical things. Anyway, so we had made this whole show, and then my non-writing producer at the time had developed a pilot presentation to prove to the network that I should star in my own show. And I have to say that this was many years in the making. It took 4 years to get the show done and everything. It was a disaster. The bottom line was, it was me trying to sell myself as a star because I'm always auditioning as the character or the friend, mm-hmm. and sometimes I'm too thin, sometimes I'm too fat, sometimes I'm not black.
You're T-O-O is what I call it.
What?
Two something.
Two something, yes, T-O-O.
I call
two.
It two, yeah.
Yeah, I was two.
Yeah.
And so it was such a disaster that Come See Me was written based on that experience. I went, you know what? I had worked with Mark Duplass on Safety Not Guaranteed. I got really into his movies. I really loved the simplicity of the minimal locations, the interaction, the human interaction. Really, it wasn't even human interaction. I felt like I was, when I was watching his movies, either he produced them or was in them, I was watching people I knew.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I want an authentic experience like that.
He also said something that I really loved. I am also in one of his films, Tangerine, that was directed by Sean Baker, and which yesterday got 5 Spirit Award nominations. Picture, director, actress, supporting actress, and a special producer award nomination for Darren Dean, who's the lead producer on the film. And there is something about, he said we were at Sundance, and he said something in front of everybody. He said, the first thing is we've got to have fun.
Hmm.
And I find so many times that you're not. People are just...
Absolutely
you're going
not.
To an official audition for something, and you... I had one Monday, and it was a couple lines and something, and I told you it on the phone. Did I tell you on the phone? And I was saying, you know, it made me feel like, you know, it's not like they were being mean or rude on purpose. It's just like, who cares about this guy coming in for a couple lines? There's 10 guys there. There was no fun in it. There was no joy. And if we're not having fun in what we do, especially if you're over 40, I'm sorry, you got to start having fun by then, you know, because half your life is gone. And and he said that, and it really hit me really hard. And it's something that I'm completely on board with all the time now. And if it's not happening and I'm not having fun, I'm not doing it.
I love that. Well, I'm going to remember that. But
yeah.
My idea of fun is control.
Uh-huh.
So I wanted control.
See, I'm not always. I can either control if it's mine or bring someone along to play, and I play with someone else. And I think it's so fun to see. You're so talented that I called you immediately and I said, I want to be a part of whatever doing. And I meant it.
Yeah,
because
I
want to go and I want to find out what I can do to have fun with you so we can get your vision in the best way possible.
That's
that excites
sweet.
Me.
Well, we will do that. I'm trying to do something before January. So you will get the phone call.
Oh, I'm in.
Okay. So so I wanted to control an experience instead of giving my control to a network or
and they
a
probably
producer.
It was like, this is really fascinating for the viewers. So what happened in this whole process?
Well, in this process.
Who played you in the pilot? That's what I'm dying to know.
Oh, we shot a pilot presentation with, we shot a pilot present, excuse me, hi. We shot a pilot presentation with me. But
they never
went to pilot with anybody else.
So you refused to do that. Wow, that I love that about you already.
Oh, I didn't refuse. They just didn't greenlight it with somebody else.
Oh my God.
So they just never got it to that process for their network.
I had a film once at Lifetime that I wrote, and they changed it so much, and it was like it didn't even seem like my movie. And then when they said no, I went, oh, and I was so happy when they decided not to do it at the last.
Because it was no longer yours.
Yes, and I never felt like that in my entire life.
I had the same
never,
experience.
Never, ever in my entire life, oh, thank God, who wants to do this piece of shit? And then the money keeps going down and down and down because, you know, if you're going to be involved, they feel
yeah.
like, and the more you want it, the more the money can go
yeah,
down.
Yeah.
And then you're going, well, I'm almost doing this for free. I might as well just do a stand-up gig or try to do something weird
right.
to make money. Yeah,
exactly. It all depends on what weird is, though.
comedy.
Coming
you
at
pulled
ya.
That thread. You just went in there and pulled that thread. You found it and you pulled it.
So I wrote Come See Me with my friend Doc Pedroli, who's an amazing writer. And I sat down and I said, I want to tell this story about sisters because I had had an experience with my mom. I was currently having an experience with dementia with my mother. I wasn't having dementia. She was having, she was severely demented. She went from standing to laying in a bed, contracted completely within 5 years.
But this film is not a drama.
It's a comedy about dementia.
And it has some moments of drama, but it really isn't. It's really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
and before you go into it more, what I want to do is I want to show the trailer for this.
Okay.
And then we're going to come back and we're going to talk more about where people can actually see the film.
Boom.
And this is the film that I fell in love with.
Oh, listen to that. That's your little girl.
Yep, she's still here, living off my freedom.
Where to, Biggie Small?
Well, I'm taking my mother to beautiful Simi Valley to see her sister.
Just 20 minutes to fix your family history.
I need your help. No, please.
Again, asked and answered. No.
Why don't you just ask your sister?
Jenica, hi. Oh, no, I'm not part of this.
You're her daughter.
I'm working.
I'm
working. Oh, honey, do you need help?
Actually, I do. That would be.
I wish I could, but my arthritis is so bad right now.
Oh. Three. Oh, God, Mom. Mom.
Fuck you.
Shh.
This is fucking bullshit.
Jenica, you've come to find out you don't know where the day will take you. So just enjoy.
You know how every family has one crazy family member, and in mine, I don't think...
Wait, let me guess. Which one is
it? Let me interrupt you. Every family has one. I don't think I'm it.
You have to embrace this time, because before you know it, you are going to be on the other side of all of it, and you don't want to have any regrets.
Oh, yeah. That's a different brother.
Sit down. Sit.
Thank you.
You must be... You look great.
Thank you. I'm so pregnant and huge.
Yeah.
You don't look. You look perfect. I'm crowning.
I'm Grant.
Reynolds. Oh. I don't know what to do with my hands.
I mean, this is pretty much just like the same thing. With, oh wait, this is.
No one wants to see her ninny goats.
He's like a bear. He's like a big bear,
yeah.
Is he?
Like, yeah.
Hold on, we'll start.
If you don't like the right pizza, go yourself.
You never know who shun a shun
Absolutely, Jason Stewart.
I think that my show is better than yours. Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
The only thing that masks alcohol while you're driving is peanuts.
Peanuts?
Have lots of when you're drinking.
Wouldn't be the first time Langdon had Skippy in his mouth.
Isn't that your dog?
He radioed me.
Get in the car.
Waka, waka, waka.
Throw another log in the fire. It's not hot enough back here.
T-Radio V. Radio and TV.
Ay, ay, ay!
Hey, what's up? I'm Casey Abrams from American Idol. You're watching Absolutely Jason Stewart on T-Radio V. It's a good take, right?
You sounded like you were completely like in a trance, like you were...
Did you feel it? Did you feel the vibes?
What's with the fakakta hair?
You don't like it?
You're a Jew, are you not?
Yeah, well,
yeah, hey, your mother would be so upset.
You shouldn't be taking...
I know. Look at everyone, look at the back of this hair. Dear God, get a brush. I'm Jason Stewart. We're on T-Radio V. TV and the radio with the hair sticking out like some sort of homeless person.
Listen, I'm sorry I have hair.
Thank you. So this film, Come See Me, we're back here with Jenica Berger. Is that right?
Every time you come back, you should call me a different name.
No,
Jenica Berger. But Berger. It's okay because it's fake. Berger is fake. Berger My mom fake. Made it up.
I'm fake too. I'm not even here. Jenica Berger. It's two names. Jenica Berger. This is a life problem.
No. Everybody has a hard time with
my name. This whole show, you can put a bleeper together that's 2 hours long of me mispronouncing everybody's name.
Don't try to say
Sweetie.
Anybody's name.
Yeah.
Sweetie. Sugar pie.
No, because this whole thing is about you, Jenica Berger. Jenica Berger. So I saw this film, and now they can see this film on iTunes. And what even more exciting, you can see it on demand in your home.
Time Warner Cable, Verizon, Google Play, PlayStation.
And the fact that you sold this through a company called Orchard is absolutely wonderful.
Thank you.
I
think Tangerine's through the Orchard.
Yes, it is. No, Tangerine is through Magnolia,
ah,
which is another beautiful flower place with growing things.
Or everything grows from these. That's where they came up with the name.
And I think it's the fact that you sold it tells people something that this film, because they don't buy everything anymore because everybody and their mother is making a movie.
Right.
You know. So people can do it. Can they also get it on DVD if they'd like?
It's not available on DVD yet. Okay. At least for the next 120 days. It's on digital. It's a digital release.
So what we need to do is we need to start telling everybody that's listening today to please go to jasonstewart.com and there's going to be a poster there of the film and say, go watch my friend Jenica Berger's new film.
Berger.
Jenica.
Don't try.
Jenica B. new
Jenica
movie.
B. There you go.
Jenica B's new movie. And I think it's really important that we should all do that and support each other because no matter what kind of an artist you are, whether you're a singer, comedian, actor, painter, I think it's really important in this day and age to do that. I really do. So tell me this. So this movie you made.
While pregnant.
While you were completely hitting the wall in terms of time, because you had a certain time frame that you were allowed to do this, and you had these people. And Tawny, the thing about Tawny I thought was so great. Tawny, tell us about Tawny, everybody, who she is.
Well, Tawny Katane was, you might remember her from rolling around with her big, long, glorious legs and her hair in the White State videos, Here I Go Again, because she was married to David Coverdale, who's the lead singer. And then she was in Bachelor Party, and she was in Gwendolyn, and she was a huge, huge star. It was like in the 80s, Tawny Katane was synonymous.
And then she got older.
With Sex Kitten, and
right.
Then she got older.
And then she got older, and she had some work done.
She had a little work done.
Which tells you, which I always say to women like that, it's the hardest thing for women like that to recreate themselves. I think after you were known for your sexuality. And what I loved about the casting of this woman in this movie is it had nothing to, even though she played a sex worker, it still had nothing to do. She was your sister that was an inappropriate sister. It could have been anybody playing
that
part. And that's what I loved about her being cast in this role. It was so unconventional. And she was fucking great.
Thank you. Oh, you can fucking curse on this?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
She was fucking amazing.
Yeah.
And fucking bananas. And fucking my sister.
And,
she walked in.
And ready to play, you could see.
She was the best improviser of everyone. She fucking walked in the room with her fucking shoes. She has amazing shoes. Like a collection that, I live in an apartment. She lives in a house that houses
her shoes.
And she walked in with her shoes and I was like, oh, she has to play my sister. There was just something about her feet. When she walked in and we instantly had a banter. And I think it's because we're both half Jewish and we don't look Jewish and we're Russian and we're just these strong women and with a lot of opinions. And she started talking about Alcoholics Anonymous and why she doesn't need it in her audition. And Mary Vernou was casting.
I love Mary Vernou's work.
But I have to say, she's amazing.
I
Mary
love
Vernou
her, love
is
her taste in what she does.
Everything. Mary Vernou does
it all.
I wish
she would love me.
Will she produce? We'll make her love
I'm
you.
I'm sort of in a movie that she cast.
Yes, you're in the
Birth
in
of the
Nate Parker's.
Yeah, but she didn't cast me. I was cast
but
by.
She's oversees everything, so she knows.
Oh, really? Oh, we'll talk about
it's
that
her
at the
movie.
Break. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
You just taught me something. Okay.
Well, she's the boss. She's not going to. Let anybody be cast without her seeing the tape
wow,
or knowing.
Well, thank you, Mary.
Yay!
I always think that nobody knows anything that's going on with me. Unless they call me directly and talk to me about it.
Right.
Isn't that weird? We're so in our own minds as actors.
Well, I wake up like that, assuming that nobody cares.
And Susan Rattan from L.A. Law, Emmy winner, has basically sort of it was here and there and just sort of disappeared. I haven't seen her, and I thought, and I know she raised a son, and I always thought she was this most interesting.
She talented. Is.
I just loved, and she was so great in the movie.
Wasn't she great?
And she was playing a role age appropriate,
yeah,
in a sense, which I love too. And she was interesting and sexy and funny, and I just loved it.
She has everything. I'm back to Tawny. James Portalacy, my producer, who I came to him with my script, and I had gotten somebody to give me a $50,000 budget and agree to giving me $50,000 to make the movie. And then they backed out. I got pregnant and they backed out. And I rewrote the script pregnant and I brought it to James Portalacy and I said, can you help me make this? We sat down for coffee and he goes, I think we can make it for $10,000. And here's how. We're going to cut these locations. We're going to make it like this. This is how many actors, and you can't have any more than that. So they need to be cut out of the script. And we'll do this for $10,000.
So every friend that you called that had a little scene here or there that you wrote for, all those gems were gone.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, if I had my way, I have 20 or 30 people in my arsenal that I want to use, but we could only use 9.
Me too, yeah.
And so he was the one who said, I'm going to say a name to play your sister. That was the most important role, because you really had to believe that we were sisters.
Barbara Streisand and...
Tawny Kitaen.
Yes.
And I was like...
Barbara would do it, and Tawny was it! I'm so crazy today.
And so when she was talking to me in her audition with her fancy shoes, I was like, she's perfect. Mary came in the room and talked to her and then left, and Mary texted me, she's perfect.
So you get one of the biggest casting directors in town on a $10 million film. I mean, $10,000 film.
Well, Mary had a personal investment in the film because, first of all, we're friends. My husband and her owned a restaurant together. We know each other very well. And her father had Alzheimer's at the same time as my mom had dementia. And incidentally, when we finished the movie in 2014, her father died, and days later, my mother died. So
you have this
connection.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, and she also, you know, Mary's not just a casting director, she's an artist, and she appreciates art, and she appreciates humor. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't know that from her films, because not that her directors are humorless. David O. Russell is one of them, who's got an amazing sense of humor. But I could always make her laugh with these stories about my mother, and she encouraged me to continue to write them. And
tell us about the gal who played your mom.
Oh my God. This woman deserves any award possible. Karen Landry.
She plays two different characters, basically, before the Alzheimer's and at the end.
In a flashback,
it's
she
almost
has,
like two different people.
It is two different people, yeah, for sure. And she, just think about this. You hand somebody a script. They have no lines in it. You tell them you're going to play their mother. You're going to look like shit. And you're going to kind of look like Weekend at Bernie's, but not dead, but look dead. And you got to drive around in a car with me for 4 days. Do you want to do it? And
we're paying you almost nothing.
And we are paying you nothing. And she just wholeheartedly, she's such a great actress that her body physically, she distorted her right arm and her mouth to look like she had no teeth. Because I had written the part toothless. Like, we were looking for a woman that just, literally I was looking for a corpse. And Mary was like, "No, I
want."
We
could play a really pretty, fun gal in another scene, younger. Can you do that, corpse Anne?
No, actually, I wrote that scene after.
Oh.
I wrote that scene, and we put that scene in after.
It really meant a lot.
It meant a lot because she was such a wonderful actress.
Well, it's not just that. No, for the film itself, I think it meant a lot, because by seeing that scene, you see what she lost.
Yeah.
And then through the whole film, you're seeing what she lost.
Well, right now,
That performance stayed so involved in your mind.
Yeah.
It really stuck in me.
Karen really sticks in me. Karen, I have a picture of her on my phone with flowers. My daughter came over and brought her flowers the other day because she calls her fake mom because she loves her so much. Fake grandma, I call her fake mom. And she's just such an incredible actress. Karen Landry.
Karen Landry.
She's married to Chris Mulkey, so her full name is Karen Landry Mulkey. And you might recognize Chris Mulk if you saw him. He has a song in the movie, and they're just an incredible couple. And so anyway, so I wrote a TV show now, having done this movie, that's sort of a prequel to Come See Me, because I was so in love with these actors that I wasn't done. So that's what I'm trying to get done before January.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
Shoot it?
Yeah. Trying to shoot it before January. Who knows how I'll get the money to edit it and do that. I'm just trying to shoot it before January.
And what are you going
to
shoot it on?
Well, we used Canon HD7s, uh-huh. So if we can get those for free, that'd be great. If wow. I could get the Blackmagic for free, that'd be great. If I just have to use my iPhone, I guess we'll have to do that, like Tangerine, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
You just need the right DP is what you really need. And so you're all over the place. You have a recurring role on Shameless. Will you be coming back next season?
I am back next season.
You play a lesbian.
I'm Tall Lisa, the lesbian who's gentrifying the neighborhood.
Tall Lisa.
Tall. There's Short Lisa and Tall Lisa. I'm Tall Lisa, and then Short Lisa is my wife.
And what was it like to work on that show with those people?
Oh, my God. Well, first of all, my family was that crazy. So then to see a movie out loud, I mean, a TV show out loud like that is awesome. And then to get to work on it with those actors.
I love watching the show.
Well, I have a crush on Steve Howie. I think he's just the sexiest thing I've ever seen in my life.
That's what's her name's...
Shinola's, yeah.
Yeah. He's naked a lot on the show.
So, oof, so hot. Yeah. And then Shinola is, all my
so
stuff
good.
Has been with Shinola and Steve Howie. And Shinola is that woman is a star to me. She is just effervescence. She is just amazing. So.
And she's effortless, her performance.
Yeah.
And I love, you know, William H. Macy.
Well, he's wonderful and sweet. And I took my daughter to Chicago with me when I was filming, and he was out in front of the hotel with a little case, and my daughter said, oh, is that a ukulele? They had a conversation for 20 minutes about ukuleles and guitars and this and that, and he very childlike went into this whole musician land with my daughter. So
this is great. We're going to take a break, and we're going to be right back with Jenica here. Jenica
Berger. Like the Follies.
On Absolutely Jason Stewart, if Jake lets us.
Hi, I'm Moby, and you're watching T-Radio V.
Yo, yo, what's up, everybody out there? This is Crazy Bone.
I am the Bum, Keith G.
And right now, you're watching T-RadioV.com.
TV and radio.
Yes. Radio and TV.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. See? Okay, yeah.
Hi, I'm Rob Hubel from Welcome to the Jungle. You're watching T-Radio V, aren't you?
Radio on TV. Terrible idea.
In TV.
You shut up. Use that one.
Hi, I'm Sheriff John Bunnell. You're watching T Radio. Radio and TV? What?
That was perfect.
Yeah, no, why are you asking me to do this after 12 drinks?
Hi, we're Marissa and Juliana Stove, the Stove Twins, and you're watching T Radio V. That's radio. In TV.
Hi, I'm Moby, and you're watching T Radio V.
Hey, what's up? This is Josh Vietti, and you're watching T Radio V.
Hi, this is Casey Abrams from American Idol, and you are watching T Radio V. That was too corny. I don't.
I loved it.
Hey, what's up? I am Scott.
And I am Ken. We are not the Chemical Brothers, but we are the Crystal Method, and you are watching T Radio V.
Hey, I'm Dean Cain, and you are watching T Radio V.
I'm watching it too. Right now. Seriously.
Perfect.
And we're back here at Absolutely Jason Stewart with Jessica.
Jenica.
Jenica! I did that purposely.
Along with John.
Josh.
Stewart.
Josh Stewart. Yeah, John. I get to talk to John Stewart a lot.
I bet.
Yeah. I wish I had his, was on that show. No, I don't. That's not even my career. That's his show. So, Jenica, you are also on the...
Let's get your glasses, Jason.
I'm on the Borscht?
The Borscht. I was on Borscht.
Is that, how
it's
do you
a cop show.
What is it called?
That has to do with beef.
Yeah. What? How do you say, what is it? The
And pickles. Bosch.
Bosch. Now, that's on which
channel? Amazon.
Hey, tell me about that show.
That was incredible. Well, my husband, who's a chef, hates show business. He doesn't even hate show business. He pays no attention to it. He knows nothing. He doesn't know who Mark Duplass is. He doesn't care about any of it, right? I tell him I get a role on Bosch, and he's like, oh, that's Harry Bosch. That's the best detective. It's a Michael Connelly novel and series, and that's what my husband reads.
Oh, wow.
Our crime novels. And so he was ecstatic.
So he tries to kill you in your sleep.
Well, no. Bosch is like this great, lovable detective who's kind of down on his luck and divorced, played by Titus Welliver.
Oh, wow.
And I was... in the first season, which just happened last year,
right.
In February, in the first season, I am Sheila Delacroix in the books. I think the book I was in was City of L.A., but City of Bones, that's the
what
book
kind of
I was
character?
In. I was a casting director who contacts them because they find some bones in Griffith Park, and I say I think it was my brother's bones.
Wow. So it's really dark.
It's very dark.
So this was not very funny. Have you done a lot of things that are not very funny?
I've done a lot not very funny. I almost forgot that I was funny.
But do you find that people don't think of you that way, or?
As funny?
Not funny.
Not funny. No, I've really got, I used to have that in my 30s, and now that I'm in my 50s.
You're not.
40s. Now that I'm 41, it's never an issue. I get to go in across the board, and I'm
on
really
on network shows.
Everything.
Oh, really?
I'm really proud of that. Except I don't get to go in for the lead of a network show. No. I'm not hot enough, thin enough, pretty enough.
Uh huh.
Mm. But I go in for the character sidekick.
Because we were talking about the beginning of before Jake so rudely interrupted us that we had to actually start the actual real show. We were talking before about the idea of the way things are cast, and I'm sort of obsessed with this. I don't know if you know, I'm the national co-chair of the Screen Actors Guild LGBT Committee, and I started that 10 years ago, so I'm also under the Screen Actors Guild Diversity Wing.
I did know that.
I volunteer there. And
that's how I met you.
Oh, it
you
is?
You were there as a guest at New Filmmakers for that reason.
Oh, right. And I won an award, too,
fine work.
Yes,
good
I won an award for civil rights recently.
Wow. Boom. Boom.
And so I'm constantly talking with the Black Committee, the Latino Committee, the Women's Committee, all the different committees, and we all have the same exact thing. It's that there's a certain kind of person you will see in network television that sometimes bleeds over into cable, that they want to play all the important roles of the things that happen to somebody, someone who's a part of the family. And it's changed in the last 20 years, more so like in comedies. Like in your movie, your husband is a chubby guy.
Love him.
And he's sexy, and I wanted him. You know what I mean? And he was great, and you guys were lovely
I'm
together.
I'm telling Josh Funk that.
But I mean, it was wonderful.
Yeah.
You know, and that's who you cast. Where it was your movie, you could have cast whoever you wanted, but you cast the guy that you connected with, I'm assuming.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
And then they seem to think on television that there's a certain kind of Calista Flockhart kind of person.
Right.
That play, that they can do anything.
Well, nothing was more clear than when we were casting my TV show, when we were in development with my TV show, of here's Jenica, who's an average-sized woman, a real-sized woman with large tatas. And yes, I have a sex appeal, but it's my own sex appeal because I'm a larger woman. And
But it isn't. Sex appeal is sex appeal.
Sex appeal is sex appeal. But we knew that the gift of the show that we were writing was that we were a real couple. So every time we would talk about who would play the Josh character, we saw him as chubby. He's a chef. He's a big guy. And there's this actor, John DiMaggio, who's a voice actor who I just am so attracted to because he's so funny and so brilliant. And I just kept saying, John DiMaggio, John DiMaggio. And everybody was like, oh, yeah, he's great. He's great. We need somebody sexy.
A sexy version of him.
Right. And then they were like, we need the sexier version of Jenica. It's sort of like Margaret Cho always blew me away. I've always loved Margaret Cho, but in the beginning, she talked about it in her stand-up when
they asked her
to lose weight to play herself.
Right.
I've had that experience
and
my whole career.
She went to a hospital, you know.
Right.
But she lost it so quickly.
I haven't had that experience because I haven't been able to give up my love of food enough to succumb to what I'm supposed to be. And frankly, I felt like if I made Come See Me and showed myself as disgusting as possible, because pregnancy is disgusting. It's not attractive. It's not glowy.
Well, to some people it is.
Whatever. They're lying to themselves. You have a basketball in the front and a basketball in the back. It doesn't look good. And I thought, this is as raw and as real as you can possibly get. And I'm just going to go with it. And I knew it would be its charm.
Well, it's the idea of this, of what a certain kind of beauty is. I have a lot of friends that are African-American women and who look African-American or who look ethnic. And they'll constantly say to me, you know, that I don't have that biracial look. And that's what most of the women who get leads and think. So when someone like Viola Davis got, you know, How to Get Away with Murder, it was almost like blah, 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 blah.
Blah.
But you notice everybody else on the show, for a while I couldn't tell anybody apart,
because everybody was just a cream color, creme brulee.
Well, it's the kind of look that they were, they all look so similar. But finally now I'm seeing them come out of who they are by watching the show, because the writing is so good, so you have to step up. But you just see that there's certain kinds of people. I'll watch a show and I'll go, Oh my God, there's someone who's fat! You know?
Finally!
Yes, right. Oh, they're the security guard. They're letting someone in. And he has three lines. You know, it's almost like they keep perpetuate this idea that we don't exist. You know, that people that are not perfect don't exist. And that the people like us don't want to watch us. We just want to watch the other people. I don't know about you. I can watch porn anytime I want. When I watch TV or watch a film or go to see a play, I want to see people that are talented and interesting.
Well, that's what I was saying about the Duplass films, is that these were people that I didn't know their names. It wasn't that interesting. It wasn't the star driven. They were just real people.
And those guys don't look like, and now they're considered sex symbols, both of them. So we're going to take a break. We're going to come right back here with Jenica on Absolutely Jason Stewart. We're going to see your demo reel and see some things that you've played, because I want to show people how fabulous you are. We'll be back in just a second. Please stay with us. Brigitte?
I'm Valerie Lansberg, and most people know me as Doris from the television series Fame. You're watching Absolutely Jason Stewart on T-Radio V. You're watching Jason Stewart on TV Radio V. Fame!
Should we jump in there at the last one?
Hi, I'm Frances Fisher, and you're watching Absolutely Jason Stewart on T-Radio V.
So it's T Radio in a V?
Yeah, T Radio V. TV with radio.
So the TV goes inside the thing.
No, the radio's inside the TV.
And then, so it's both?
Yeah.
And that's my show?
That's your show.
And you just did my show?
Yeah.
Oh, God, I'm so excited. I feel like we're crashing into a Titanic. Oh, sorry.
Hi, this is Casey Abrams from American Idol, and you are watching T Radio V. That was too corny. I loved
it.
Hi, this is Danny Woodburn, and you're watching T Radio V. Did it come up? Are you all right? There we go. He's good.
And we're back at Absolutely Jason Stewart with my guest, Jenica Berger. It's Berger. Oh, I can't talk right now. I'm on the air. If this were another person's show, Jake, that we'd be
answering. Is that David Tochterman?
No, this is a friend who's not in show business. I'm going to put it near my crotch so I can feel it. So what I want to do is I want to show, and we're going to leave the sound on. We're going to show. I want to show your demo reel and some of the really wonderful things that you've done. And do we have that ready, Jake? Let's take a look.
Yeah. Check it out now.
Oh, that's so old.
Such a vibrant thing.
But this is really cool thing.
A vibrant thing.
But that's why I'm named.
Al, I am telling you, he loves it
so
here.
Old.
He's having a great
time.
He's trying out for the school play.
It doesn't matter. You're so good.
No,
Elizabeth, be honest with me now. Is our son a homosexualist? I'll accept him, whatever he is.
Well, I'm loving him as much,
obviously. But I'll accept him.
Yes, yes, he is. And he's marrying his boyfriend in Vermont this weekend. And then they're off to join Cirque du Soleil. David likes girls, believe me. There's even one who seems to have a crush on him. It's so cute.
Really? Not just some fat girl he shares bitchy gossip?
Oh, I was so thin.
Look, that's great. But I just don't believe my son doesn't want to come home with me.
She sucked the life out of me.
You don't believe in the female orgasm.
Would you like red or white?
Red.
Red. It is.
Daryl would drink beer with everything.
What was Dila?
I mean, if he could have a keg with dinner.
I mean,
can we talk about it, brother?
He would.
Would you like to order?
Vegas,
I'll be right back.
He was so nice. I loved it.
Now that is the kind of thing that would drive Daryl crazy. You're here now. He'd say, so take our order.
Thank you, dude.
Look at the presence that you have.
Talk about Daryl a lot.
Well,
and the specificity, that's a word.
We're married for 7 years.
Of everything you do.
He didn't tell you that?
I wish I was you when I grew up.
Must have slipped his mind.
Yeah, well, that's just like him. I'm going to go hit the head.
And then you did this film called Satisfactory, Not Guaranteed. Is that what it?
Safety, not guaranteed.
Let's show a little bit of that. This I loved. And this is also directed by the guy who directed Jurassic Park.
Right, Colin Trevorrow. It was his Sundance hit. And it won the Waldo Emerson Salt Award, something like that.
At Sundance?
At Sundance.
And did you go to Sundance?
I did.
What was that experience like?
It was great to see the film. I absolutely love the film.
Did you find that people were hitting on you, to agents and managers and all that kind of stuff?
I did actually have some action with that, because I had just tested for Charlie Sheen's show and it was in Deadline, so people thought I was somebody.
Oh, wow.
But I didn't get the Charlie Sheen show, and I wasn't the star of Safety Not Guaranteed, so it quickly went away with the snow.
But still, let's take a check and look at this. Now, who's that actor?
Jake Johnson.
Jack.
Hey.
Liz, it's great to see you.
Look at you.
Look at
your
you.
Your hair color changes.
This is where you live.
A lot.
This is my house.
I want to say I'm sorry about yesterday. I was going to come, but work's getting crazy.
I was sad because you got me thinking about you on that Facebook. I never thought I'd see you again.
Never thought I'd see you again.
Oh, God. Excuse me. Would you come in?
I'd love to. Your hair's red.
Yeah.
It's different.
Yeah, I change it. It's just about the only thing I've changed.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, kinda. What about you?
A lot's changed. Almost like everything.
I mean,
I got an Escalade, and you know, my job's going really well. Got a great condo.
Tell me about your life.
I just did.
I've got to read this magazine of yours.
Oh, don't.
That is so exciting.
It's not that exciting.
You know what? I always thought you'd do something special with your life.
I mean, if you knew what it was really like, you wouldn't say it was special.
Oh, come on.
What's
wrong with your neck?
Oh, sorry, I'm David. It's just I got this shooting pain. I have to share a bed with a male intern, and I don't feel like rubbing asses with him, so.
Let me see.
You don't have to do that.
Oh. Ooh, you need to put some heat on that.
I do?
Oh, I have pies in the oven.
You make pies?
I made some pies. I made a peach, apple, strawberry rhubarb. Which one do you want?
Yeah. Oh.
Do you know what I really loved about that performance? And I'd seen it before, but I didn't know how to download it when I was doing research on you, is that, and I've not seen the film, is you played someone who wanted to be with the guy, right?
Mm-hmm.
But didn't want the guy to know that you wanted to be with the guy. Am I right?
Yeah. Well,
I love the way you did that. And I don't know the story because I didn't see the film. And I thought, this is, I couldn't keep my eyes off of you.
In
that. I kept going back to you, even though he's really good looking and I'm a gay guy, you'd think I'd like him better. If he were doing porn, I'd be more interested.
Probably.
Not that he wasn't a good actor. But I'm just saying that was, I love that, and there's a certain and you do that a lot. You'll always plan like two or three things in something. And I love, and that's what I really liked about watching your work.
Oh, thank
and
you.
And going through the things. There's always something else going on. And I had an acting coach, you know, folks that always used to say, always be coming from someplace, always be going to someplace.
Right.
You know, and that seems to show in your work.
You, I don't think it's conscious.
I do it consciously.
I don't know if I don't think I remember when I'm acting, the nerves are so high or the moment is so in the moment that I don't think I'm going to have two things going at the same time. Like, I remember somebody asked me on an episode of Ally McBeal when I touched my necklace, how had I endowed that? And I said, I knew the camera was on me. And I knew it was my close-up, so I gave them a couple of things. And he meant, what was the history of the endowment with the necklace? And I just thought, maybe I'm too much of a film actor, but I know that they're going to get a take, and I should probably be uncomfortable because I'm uncomfortable in this situation, in this courtroom. So I don't have a conscious thought about that, but I think the reason why that performance was great was honestly because Colin Trevorrow, the director, mm-hmm. he was such a fan of mine, and he really, we started out really big, and he came in and he said, you're so pretty and you're so sexy. And the character's not supposed to be pretty or sexy to the guy. He said, so just let him come to you and let's see how that goes.
Oh, that's an interesting thing to play.
Yeah.
Especially for you, because I'm assuming you're the one that goes first.
Right.
You're a doer.
Right.
You walk in and you take your shit and you go.
Right. So that really, really changed my performance. And then there was another scene where I'm massaging and my boobs are right in the camera, and he let me know. He said, I just want you to know so you're not surprised when you see the film. It's a great shot, but your boobs are in the shot, and you're massaging his hands. I was like, oh, yeah, you can have my tits. I don't care. And he was like, no, I want you to know, because it's very funny while you're massaging and he's trying to not be attracted to you. Your breasts are in the shot. And I thought that was so, I really appreciated that. It's no surprise to me that he became this huge director.
What is your first big thing that sort of changed your career, that put you on the planet, you know, that stamped you, that said, hey, this gal's someone we should look for?
Drew Carey, Drew Carey Show, playing the plumber. Playing his love interest, the plumber. That's when people started to notice me in Vegas or Florida or places I vacation.
In the industry?
In the industry, it was Larry Sanders. I did an episode of Larry Sanders where every time I would kiss Wally Langham, who was his comedy writing was bad. And it was called Pain Equals Funny. And every time we were broken up, his comedy writing was great. And everybody watched that show. So,
because there's a difference. Drew Carey was a audience show,
right?
And Larry Sanders was a show business show, and there's a big difference,
right?
Because you can be a big hit. I used to be on My Wife and Kids, and that's an audience show,
right?
That
show.
And people would know that. And then if you do, you know, Sex in the City or some cool show that the industry watches, everybody goes nuts,
right?
I want to remind people that they can come see me on demand almost everywhere, and iTunes
and Amazon Video.
And Amazon Video, and it's wonderful.
Thank you.
And I'm so, so thrilled for you. And if people want to get you, they can go to your website.
JenicaBergere.com.
If you can spell it.
JenicaBergere. Or just go to Come See Me. Come, and See Me is spelled like SIMI.
Yes.
Like Simi Valley.
It's all so confusing. So if there's someone like me and you cannot remember anything because I've totally butchered her name, just go to jasonstewart.com, STUART, and I will send you to where you need to go.
Thank you.
This is so wonderful. I'm so glad that you were able to be on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Your car in Santa Monica. And
Venice.
Wherever it is that you live. Because, you know, for those of people who live in Los Angeles, you can go to Santa Monica. You just can't get out. Something happens. So everyone, please don't forget. You know, I'll be here next week for a couple
weeks. And congratulations
weeks.
To you with Tangerine. That's so exciting.
Yes. It's so exciting. And congratulations to Sean Baker and Darren Neen and Maya Taylor and everybody involved with the show. Thank you so much. Until next week, stay with us. Don't change that channel. Oh, my God. We don't have a channel. Take care, everybody.
You are watching T Radio V. Radio and TV.